Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Our prayer is that as we have worshiped the Lord in song today, it has prepared your heart to receive the preached word of God. May it fall on good soil and bring lasting fruit in your life. Welcome to the King Series.
Father, I just pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would give us revelation of your word. It is the interest of your word to bring us light and life, and I pray that the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ will shine bright in here today. I pray, God, that as the word grows, it will break up the fallow ground of the heart, and the word will be planted, God, that will bring forth fruit, and the fruit will remain, God, a hundredfold return on it, God. Give us ears to hear and hearts to obey. Now, Lord, would you please think through my mind and speak through my mouth. At this time, let the word to my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Lord, you are my strength, and you're my redeemer. In every glad and agreeable, happy heart, say amen. Hello. Well, I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, come on, y'all from church. I was glad when they said unto me, come let us go into the house of the Lord. Y'all better learn how to clap. I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, I was glad when they said unto me, come let us go into the house of the Lord. Anybody happy to be here? All right, 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 all right. Queens, kings are not my subject today, independent of one another, but we're going to talk about kings and queens together. I'm going to bridge in this sermon the two. 3 weeks on queens, the bridge, kings and queens, and then we'll finish off with the kings. I am so appreciative that we have decided as a church to talk about the queens of the Bible or women of the Bible, because I believe that we have not done women the proper service or given them the proper acknowledgement that we should, credit or hand up in society that we should. As an African American, I am grateful for every European or any other ethnic group that helped during the struggle of the African or the African American when they were not considered even a whole human being and they were in servitude. When someone of another ethnic group said, I'm not in their circumstance, but I'll feel what they're feeling. I'll be bound with them. I will take that same penalty. I will pick up that cause and I will fight against that injustice because it's just not right. We're all God's people. I'm grateful. Somebody lifted me up. It's why I can stand before you and preach today. Now, it seems the same in the same regard that we must address some gender issues. At times, we don't want to address them. And I'm not a woman, but I have heard women. That's clear. Just, I'll bow up. So in other words, I don't know through experience what it feels like to be a woman. I don't know the full measure of the struggle or the joys. But I do know at times it can appear to be a secondary position. After all, when you get to the doctors, and before, you know, the ultrasound stuff existed, everybody was waiting around to see if a little boy would come out. Seemed as if it was a little bit more joy if your first child was a boy. Whenever we studied the monarchs, everybody was more focused on the boy than the girl. And it seems as if this emphasis is not just a human emphasis. It seems as if it's overall. It's a secondary position. I'm going to dispel this myth today. That's why I'm grateful for talking about Sarah. I'm grateful for us talking about Esther. I'm grateful for us talking about Sheba. Powerful women. Women who endured much things. Sarah enduring her lying husband. Somebody just said, my husband was lying yesterday. people like the Queen of Sheba, who was successful yet humble. Powerful yet submissive. In authority, yet she wore it with dignity. And humility, she had class. There's so many things to learn and prize. However, society has tried over time to limit women to their external packaging and train men to limit them and to base their value of them based on what they can see only on the outside. Oh yeah, she fine. And now y'all know I'm telling the truth in church. Now don't do that to me. Then I don't got time to be proving everything. Let's just tell the truth in here. Even though the word says, don't let it be the external things that attract you to a woman, like the plaiting the hair, the wearing of gold or apparel, but let it be the secret person of the heart, which is of a meek and a quiet spirit. God is giving you different selection criteria. He's trying to get you to focus on the beauty on the inside instead of the things on the outside. There's nothing wrong with the external package, but that's not the whole of a person. I'm so grateful that Sarah was marked as being beautiful, but she was much more than a beauty. Esther was beautiful, but she was brave and bold and articulate and strong and wise. These characteristics are great. When I was growing up, there was a movie out. That I'm not recommending because I don't recommend movies, but I didn't see it when I was young. Eddie Murphy was in it. He emphasizes my point. This woman comes out with her hands. He sees this woman. Some of y'all know. And the words come out. I used to get invited to weddings to say, she's your queen to be, vision of perfection. You're in the right church. That just happened. Limited to the external. And the plague is everywhere. The virus is deep. I want to root it out, not by celebrating now because we just celebrated women or just celebrating just a man, but by taking you back to the original purpose of the pairing and the power within it. Genesis 1. And the 26th verse, then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and in heaven of the livestock of all the earth and all the creeping things on the earth. So God created man or human Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, male and female. God said to them, be fruitful, or the Message Bible says, prosper. Multiply, or reproduce. Fill the earth, and have dominion. Here God is giving the purpose for humanity, male and female, is to prosper, is to reproduce, fill the earth, and dominate. Even though there was only one man created, the Bible says the mandate was to them. The word was to them, male and female. The purpose was to them. Now within this, you can prosper as a male or female, but you cannot reproduce without both a male and female. You cannot fill the earth without both a male or female, but you can dominate as a male or as a female. Half of the assignment you can do as a male or a female, and half of the assignment you can only do if you have a male and a female together. So God is initiating purpose, and within this purpose, when you say yes to it, is your act of worship toward God. He did not make male and male because he would not be able to reproduce and fill. But he would be able to prosper and dominate. He did not make female and female because he wouldn't be able to reproduce and fill. But he would have been able to prosper and dominate. Purpose is established from the beginning. He says that we shall reign with him as kings. We are a kingdom of priests. And he says we'll reign with him on earth. We'll reign with him in heaven. Revelation 3:11 says, make sure that no one steals from you your crown, which speaks of your authority, which speaks of your kingdom opportunity when you say yes to your responsibility. Now, we are absolutely, as a society, obsessed with royalty and monarchs, even though we don't want to be ruled by anybody. You know, America rejected monarchy. But we do like to watch it. In fact, when Kate and William, they got married, 2 billion people, 2 billion people tuned in and watched that. They didn't pay us. They didn't pay you. They didn't pay me. You watched it. We watched it. Obsessed with it. Yet, the system that we're watching is the very system that was established from the beginning and the very one that we reject now because it has too much authority connected to it and within it. I'm going to give you three words that help us now as we look in our text in Genesis further. What did God do now to help us express this purpose to prosper, reproduce, fill the earth, and to dominate as an act of worship to him. He gave us a partnership. And then when the partnership came, also, only when the partnership came, there also came a problem. There was no problems before the partnership. My life was cool. I was all right. It was just me, myself. I ain't had no problem. But then, you know, and now I got problems. But for every problem you have, God's got a promise. The partnership, there comes a problem that God solves with a promise. I was telling my son on vacation, I said, what are your goals? You've got to focus on a goal to be motivated in life. And I said, mine was God's purpose for me is to make a global impact in everything that I do of value. To make a global impact in everything I do of value. Because I'm going back to my mandate to prosper and to dominate. It is my right and my responsibility and my opportunity should I pick it up, because I find no scripture that says I've lost it. My second focus as an act of worship was to find my partner, my boo, my mate, my All right. Genesis 2. Let's go. Then the Lord God said, it's not good that man should be alone working out his prosperity in the garden. Prospering in the garden. Dominating in the garden. Doing what I assigned him to do in the garden. It's not just good for him to do it alone. But he's doing what I purposed. But he's only doing half of it. I will make him a helper fit for him. Now, out of the ground, the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. Pay a special attention to the next words in this text. I'm going to read that again because this is critical. Now, out of the ground, the Lord God had formed every beast of the field and every bird of the heavens and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. Before you can have a earthly partner, you've got to have a heavenly partner. God said, Adam, I'm willing to trust you at the level that I will let you name every animal. I'm not going to tell you what to name them. I trust that if I bring them to you, you will give me the answer. Adam, I'm interested in what you think. I'm interested in what you will say. Lord, I'm just waiting on a word. You just give me the word and then I'll say it. Elephant, I'll say elephant. I'll say it, Lord, I'll say elephant. I just need a word from you. No, Adam, I already gave you a word. I already gave you a garden. I already told you don't eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Adam, I've already told you to prosper. I've already told you to dominate. I've already given you everything you need. Now name these animals. You've got a word. I'm interested in your mind. A lot of us get held up from doing anything of value because you don't know how to connect with God. Before you can get a spouse, before you can get a child, before you can get a job and actually get promoted, you've got to get a partner, and your partner's got to be God. And you've got to get a relationship with Him when you already know you're intuitively designed and wired to prosper in whatever you do and put your hands to, because you've got a word to prosper. You've got a word to dominate. You've got a word to excel and a word to accelerate. You are always going to be on top. Why? Because God has given you a word already with the parameters that keep you safe. What do you want to name, madam? I'm cool with it. Well, that's a what should you midget it? What should you midget? Next. And he said, whatever that man called him, that was their name. Look at that partnership. God didn't say, well, I came back and fixed it. He said, no. Whatever he said, that's what it was. That's what it was. Look at God's trust. God's trust of us within the kingdom. It's king. The word of the king is final. You want to know if you're a king or a queen? Look at the authority he's given you. Over his king. He's walking with you in partnership. He's walking with you in authority. These are not some Christian little cute little words. We're just kingdom people. We're you're God's children. Look at us. No. He's treating us with people who as people who have authority with him. The man gave names to all the livestock, to the birds in the heavens, to the beasts of the field. And Adam was there. He said, but for Adam, there was not found a helper fit for him. Adam kept saying, got a male ox. You with a female ox. Y'all a couple? Go. Got a male chicken. Female chicken. Y'all married? Y'all, go. Got a male lamb. Got a female lamb. Y'all can go. And I see your ability to fulfill two parts of the assignment that I can't. Reproduction and fulfilling the earth. And I see no one fit for me to fulfill the assignment. Though purpose is born in me, though I am dominating, though I am prospering, this I cannot do. So the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, fell asleep. God took out one of his ribs and closed up the place in his flesh. Notice he did not take out a toe bone, piece of the forehead. Significance. This is not subservience. Now you got to do what I say, baby. Let's just deal with that for a second. Let me park 30 seconds here. Yeah. You get married to somebody. Do what I say. Do what I say. Didn't I tell you? Calm that down now. Calm down. You're going to lose her. Even if she stay with you, you'll lose her. You'll break her. See, you're a breaker. Back that up. Reverse that. You in the inspiration motivation business. You're trying to offer something for her through a choice of her will, which God won't violate, to say yes to. You're a leader, which denotes that you're not grabbing her by the back of the neck and say, yes, where we going? Now you're saying, look, trust me. Let's go this way. Okay, I'll wait. I'm too fast? Okay, we can wait longer. Okay? But we going together, though. Well, you got a better idea? God showed me something, but I'm willing to let you try that. But it's okay. You know, at least you tried. That's all right. We can fix it. All right, are we ready to go now? Okay, let's go. See, never had to grab the neck. Never had to yell. Just let all that go. And this is a long message. Come on. And the rib that the Lord God had made from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Notice that God put him in a deep sleep. That God took the rib. That God brought the woman to the man while the man was doing the work of purpose. Not the work of frustration. Not the work of what about me? Not the work of I gotta get mine. Not the work of what about that honey? Not the work about he did the work of patience and the work of focus and the work of dedication. Yo, I have to say amen. It's an amen going off in my heart from God. Say, hey, you doing good, brother. They don't like it. They don't. He said, and so then the man said, "Woo! This is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. God, I see what you did. Wombed man. I couldn't reproduce and fill the earth, but now you've given me someone almost like me, but they have features and they have organs and they have things. There's a womb there where I can fulfill the other two parts. Hallelujah. Oh, woman, I appreciate you for who you are. I'm not asking you to be a man. I'm not asking you to have my strength because I was born 2 times stronger than you. I was born more left brain, yet you're more right and left brain. I'm not penalizing you for being able to outthink me. I'm not penalizing you for having all those emotions. My kids need it. I recognize the difference and I say, woman, you came from me. I value you. Woman, we can finish this. Therefore a man shall leave his father and his mother and hold fast his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Here's the first time Adam's having to recognize, Daddy, Abba, God the Father Almighty, Creator, I don't need you on this one. There's things I can have to do that don't involve you now. I have to leave you. I have to cleave to her. And we have to become one flesh. And here's the first time that the word wife is used. She's not just woman. She's not just female. Because I'm going to not just verbally confess she's my wife, I'm going to consummate it with an act. Of, you know what, I don't say it's PG-13, I don't know if it's kids, I don't know if you teach your own kids at home. Now it's out of my mouth and it's followed up with the act. I'm making it clear. And so man cannot define what God defines from the beginning. The first time wife is said is by God. And he follows it up with the first mention of the most searched word on the internet. It's 3 letters. And the man and his wife both were naked and were not ashamed. Isn't it funny? Well, you know, we need more instructions in the church for the children. They need to know what's going on. We need some education classes so people can know what's going on. If the kids had more instructions, they would. Who told you that? Now, where was God? He didn't give me no instructions. Y'all be one, go. Privacy. In fact, we want to keep our kids from the knowledge of evil. It's purity here. God innately, he innately knew.
Bone of my bone.
How did he know that? God puts it in you. How does a mother know how to nurse? It's innate. The innate quality of a baby is to come out sucking. It's innate. Don't let the world come in and bring a virus to you that pollutes our mind to think more worldly thoughts. Our God is so pure that he can articulate something that is beautiful and wonderful, and none of our minds while we're sitting in church is violated. But for all of the unity, for all of the partnership with God, and then his first partnership with his wife, there's a problem. Here he comes. Read. I'm going to read. Next verse. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field. And the Lord God had made, he said to the woman, did God actually say you should not eat the tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat from the tree in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. But the serpent said to the woman, you're not surely die, for God knows that when you eat, your eyes are going to be open, and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to her eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. The eyes of both of them were open, and they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and they made themselves loincloth. Number one, why are you talking to another person on your honeymoon? That's wrong. See, that's what you don't want to do. Just too much talking. Talk to Adam. Hanging out talking to him. You just got married. This is a rule of thumb. Don't be talking to extra people. Just turn your phone off. Just see, that's your trouble come in. Talking to somebody else. Adam. Oh, sorry, brother. Covering. Supposed to have Eve's back. The Bible says Eve was deceived, but Adam was not. Which means Eve is getting tricked in front of Adam. She's standing there. Yeah, Adam. Yeah, I don't know. And God. He just standing there like, yeah, I wonder how this is going to go. He didn't pipe in, yeah, God said we're going to die, baby. Get away from him. He going to wait to see she eats the fruit. Let's see what's going to happen to her. Well, she didn't die. The snake said she wasn't going to surely die. Give me some of that. Now he eating him some. Fell in the cover. She's failing it. But watch this. This is the kicker. Here is their first opportunity to do all four things that God has called them to do. Be fruitful. Prosper, reproduce, and fill. How come the next verse didn't say Cain and Abel was born? Instead of getting busy with purpose, they mess around. Whenever you don't engage yourself in your assignment, whenever you leave it on the ground, whenever you lose focus, you're in trouble. Well, I don't know if I want to dominate Pastor James. I don't know if I want to prosper Pastor James. I don't know if I'm really into all this. Wait a minute. You better get focused. I don't know if I'm into that. You fight for unity with your spouse. Well, we just don't see eye to eye. We just two different feathers, you know. Work it out. Work on it. Gonna be a long summer. Divorces take a long time. I don't know who that's for, but divorces take a long time. They do sometimes happen for valid reasons. And even God mentioned giving Moses permission to give people opportunities to write bill of divorce for valid reasons. But what I see is a whole lot of invalid reasons come past me. So if you're one of the invalid reason people, then hold on, because you're inviting more pain than anything. And I love you. I was just trying to tell you this. But here's what happens while you have a problem. When you reject the truth of God, here's what happens. Go to Romans 1. Let me give you an example. We almost done. I'll let you off the hook in a little bit. I don't know. I know, but smile or something. There you go. Roman 1. Put that Roman 1 up there. Ooh. Go down 25. Verse 25. Because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie. Whenever you can hear the truth about purpose, God's purpose for humanity, God's purpose for your life to prosper, reproduce, fill the earth, and to dominate or rule, and as an act of worship to him. When you exchange that truth for lie and worship and serve the creature more than creator, who is blessed forevermore. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions. For women exchange the natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another. Men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. God, when you encounter a problem, does not change his nature to force you. Well, if God doesn't like stuff, why don't he just send lightning bolts to stop it? Well, it's not like him, because he would have sent a lightning bolt and killed the snake at the tree. Your ability to make a choice for him or against him is what makes you human, what makes this real. He is not going to intervene, but he doesn't change. And when man's thoughts and imaginations became continually wicked after Adam and Eve sinned, and the whole world became so wicked that he was going to destroy it with a flood, he chose four women and four men and put them on a boat and chose animals, every male animal and every woman, a female animal, and put them on a boat to start all over again. And you know what he did? Gave Noah the same mandate that he gave Adam. Prosper, reproduce, fill the earth, and rule. It never changes. So what happened? God comes to Adam, but he has a promise within the midst of the punishment. He says, Adam, I'm just preparing a phrase now. You go on and you can read it. He says, Adam, where you at? He said, did you eat of the tree I told you not to?
He said, Lord, you know that woman you gave me, you know how she is. That's not what he asked him. He said, did you eat? But he blames the woman. The woman blames the snake. The curse goes to the snake. Multiply sorrow to the woman. Hard labor to the man. But you know what never changes? The mandate. You know what God never takes away? Hear me. He never takes away the purpose. Within all of the punishment, hear me. He never takes away your kingly right, your kingly opportunity as a son or daughter of God Most High. He never takes it away. And when you engage in the promise of redemption, when you accept the free gift, the wages of sin is death, but the promise, the free gift of God is eternal life. The opportunity to live and reign with him through accepting his sacrifice for your sin. Verse 20 goes on to say he made a covering. He made skins to cover them up until he would die on the cross and pay the price for them to live with him eternally. Stand to your feet. He's got a promise for you. The Bible says that he could not take away Adam and Eve's ability to reject him. But you know what I love? What 1 Peter says? Behold, he was a lamb slain before the foundations of the world. That even if we would choose to reject him, he chose from the beginning to accept us. That he made a way, even when we said no to him, he said yes to us. God's love for us is even that when we are sinners and dead and trespassing in sin, Christ died for us. Even when we said no to him, even when we acted like we didn't love him, even when we didn't act kingly, queenly, princely, even when we encountered problems, there was a promise that he would never leave us nor forsake us. There was a promise that we would crush his head. He would bruise, Jesus' head would be bruised. There was a victory at the cross. He did not change his plan to have you rule and reign with him in this life and the next forever. God loves you that much. Bow your heads. Close your eyes. And Pastor Randy, you have it up in the upper venue. You guys, bow your heads and close your eyes. Ministry team, you come down. I'm simply going to ask you a question as we close. He loves you so much. Maybe you're here today and you've found that you have a disposition in opposition to the will or word of God. You heard something in this message. Maybe you're not in sin, but man, I just didn't agree with God, his way of thinking, his way of living. I need to get that right. Maybe you're in here and you have sin. Maybe in here you need healing. Maybe in here you need to be filled. Maybe in here you need a friend. Maybe in here you need a question answered. Maybe in here you just need to become a greater follower of Jesus. Maybe you're here, you just need to accept the responsibility to prosper and to dominate, to rule, to win in life on your job, to win in your family. And you just need somebody to pray with you. When I conclude this dismissal prayer, if you meet that description, you need anything, I'm going to invite you to come down and we're going to pray for you at the conclusion of this service. Lord, I pray that you bless your people today. Bless us to remember that we're not ordinary because you're an extraordinary God. You blessed us, God, not to just live and exist, but to prosper, to rule over your great creation as stewards, not as dictators and wicked men, but as caretakers. God, we do care for your creation. We care to help others to prosper in it, just like you did. We lead the way you led us, through sacrifice, through giving of our life. I pray you bless each person as they leave and anybody that needs to come down that they wouldn't leave without coming down. God, as we go with us. Keep us in the center of your will and the apple of your eye. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Romans 10 and 9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I believe this is one of the greatest promises in the entire Bible. And I'd like an opportunity right now to pray with you, and you have an opportunity to receive eternal life. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and I need a Savior. I believe that you died on the cross for me. I believe that he raised you from the dead on the third day. And with this confession from my heart, I am saved and I am no longer the same. And Jesus is now Lord of my life. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, I am so happy for you, but all of heaven is rejoicing with you. Your next step is to get in a Bible-believing church and allow somebody to help you follow Jesus.